Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Heathcliff Redux, a novella and stories by Lily Tuck. Narrated by Gabra Zackman. Heathcliff Redux. Whether it is right or advisable to create beings like Heathcliff, I do not know. I scarcely think it is. But this I know. The writer who possesses the creative gift owns something of which he is not always master, something that at times strangely wills and works for itself. Charlotte Bronte. Of course I had read Wuthering Heights. I read it years ago in high school, but in my late 20s, I decided to read it again. I also had seen the movie version with Merle Oberon and Laurence Olivier, and I particularly remember the scene, early on in the film, that presages the character's tragic misconceptions. Catherine tells Heathcliff how she thinks he is a prince in disguise, and that his father must have been the Emperor of China, and his mother an Indian queen. I first saw Cliff, everyone called him that, in April, at a steeplechase race. Charlie, my husband, and I, and Meryl and Frank, our neighbors, had driven over there together. The back of our truck was loaded with hampers filled with food, wine, and bottles of bourbon. The race was a popular annual event, attended by people, mostly gentry, from all over the county. Originally a single race with gentlemen riders, the event had grown to include several races, and the riders were no longer necessarily gentlemen. The course was 4 miles long, and the fences were tall and timber. Charlie and I were both riders, and we owned a couple of thoroughbred hunters. We knew a lot of the horse people at the race. After all, we had been going there for several years. And before one of the races, Charlie and I walked over to the paddock where the horses and their riders were getting ready, tightening girths, adjusting stirrups, and mounting their horses. And it was there that I first saw, no, stared at, Cliff. My husband saw him too because he made some comment. I don't remember exactly what he said. Something like, "Geez, look at how that guy gets on his horse." That was it exactly. Instead of getting a leg up the way most of the riders did, Cliff just jumped into the saddle, like he was a Cossack or something. A leap, I would call it, and his horse was at least 16 hands tall. It was impressive. I remember how it looked to this day. To my dying day, probably. Charlie and I lived on a 400-acre farm in Albemarle County, Virginia, one of the richest counties in the country. Charlie had grown up on the farm, and now he managed it for his parents, who had retired to Florida. Besides the horses, he raised beef cattle, Black Angus. For a while, he kept a bull, but then artificial insemination became popular and more convenient. It was also cheaper, and Charlie got rid of the bull. His name was Hannibal. I was glad, because even if he was kept separate in a field, I was afraid of him. During the steeplechase race, a big bay gelding named Patrick's Dream fell after clearing a jump and broke his front leg. Both front legs, someone later told Charlie, and they had to put him down. Luckily, I didn't see that. I just saw the truck dragging the harness go out onto the field. Always an upsetting sight. Briefly, I wondered whether it was the leaper's horse who had broken his legs, but it wasn't. The leaper had been riding a gray horse. I have always been partial to gray horses. Native Dancer, who won the Preakness and the Belmont, was a gray. He just missed winning the Kentucky Derby and getting the Triple Crown. Eric Guerin, his jockey, was blamed for taking him all over the track except the ladies' room. But he was named U.S. Champion 3-year-old colt in 1953 and U.S. Horse of the Year in 1954. From our house, I could see the Blue Ridge Mountains in the distance. The reason the mountains appear blue and hazy, I have been told, is on account of the isoprene released from the trees. Besides the beef cattle, we grew corn to feed them. In the summer, Charlie and a couple of hired farmhands harvested the corn. Some days the temperature reached 100 degrees, and the humidity made the heat feel a lot worse. Always in the air, there was the threat of rain, or worse, of a thunderstorm. One summer it hailed, hail as big as grapefruits, breaking car windshields and most of the storefront windows in town. At midday, I drove the truck down to the field bringing the men cold lemonade and ham sandwiches. I usually wore shorts, and I can still recall how my legs stuck uncomfortably to the plastic seat. My hands, too, were sweaty, which made it difficult to hold the wheel and steer. "How's it going?" I asked. "Hot as hell," Charlie would answer. Next time, bring me a beer, he also said. The hired hands took the sandwiches and the lemonade without saying a word and without looking at me. Both of them were black. I think it's going to rain, I said, looking up at the sky and trying to engage.
You better get back in the truck and go home, Charlie said.
The year was 1963, and the early 60s was still a relatively innocent time, innocent at least for middle-class people like Charlie and me. We did not do drugs, we did not get divorced, and we did not have abortions or extramarital love affairs. Or if we did, we did not talk about them. As yet, Martin Luther King Jr. had not been shot and killed. Nor had anyone whom I knew or had heard of. The next time I saw Cliff was at the Keswick Hunt Club ball. I normally tried to avoid those events. Not only did I have to get dressed up, but I had to get a babysitter. Also, Charlie tended to drink too much, and I'd have to drive the truck home at God knows what hour in the morning. Cliff was dancing cheek to cheek with a woman I knew slightly. Her name was Sally. When Sally saw me looking at her and Cliff, she waved at me with the hand that was resting on Cliff's shoulder, and I waved back. Sally was a rich widow in her late 40s. She owned a grand historic house that had once been a plantation and was often compared to Monticello. The house was open to the public a few times a year to benefit a local charity, and several times it had been written up and photographed in fashion magazines. Sally's husband, who died the year before in a car accident, his car overturned in a drainage ditch at night, and he was pinned inside it and not found until the next morning when it was too late, had been at least 15 years older than Sally, and he had made his fortune with some paper products. I've forgotten what they were exactly. Packaging, I think. They did not have children. Sally wasn't beautiful, but she was attractive and had a good, trim figure. She was an excellent sportswoman. She rode. She was a whipper-in at the local hunt. Was a good shot. Played golf and tennis. And I don't know what else. She was also on a bunch of committees, at the library in town, a small liberal arts college in Lynchburg, the hospital, because she gave to them generously. I couldn't fault her for that. In fact, I couldn't fault her for anything, not even for dancing with Cliff.
Banish him from your thoughts, miss. He's a bird of bad omen. No mate for you.
Nellie, both narrator and housekeeper in Wuthering Heights, warns. Hannibal, our bull, was not an Angus, but a Charolais. The Charolais is one of the top meat-producing breeds, and Charlie had bought him with the hope of improving our herd. The Charolais comes from Charol, France, and was imported to Mexico in 1930. Hannibal, according to an article I read, could trace his lineage back to two Mexican bulls called Neptune and Ortolan. Ortolan? An Ortolan is a tiny bird the size of my thumb that weighs less than an ounce. It is a French delicacy prepared by first throwing the bird into a vat of Armagnac to both marinate and drown it, then cooking it for 8 minutes and serving it whole. Traditionally, diners eat ortolans, heads, bones, and all, with a napkin thrown over their heads. What does Cliff stand for? I asked when at last I met him. Clifford?
Something like that, he answered, smiling.
It was at a cocktail party celebrating Sally's 49th birthday. I was drinking my second glass of wine and wearing a sleeveless white dress. Or does it stand for Heathcliff? I persisted. You know, Heathcliff in Wuthering Heights.
Heathcliff? Who's that?
Cliff asked, still smiling. You've never read Wuthering Heights? Right away, I regretted saying that. I was afraid of sounding superior and assuming he did not read books and was not, like me, educated. Since he did not answer, I said lamely, It's one of my favorite novels. I'm rereading it now.
Is that so? Cliff said.
Nervous, I nodded, and in spite of feeling myself start to blush, I went on. Heathcliff is the hero, or more accurately, the anti-hero, who—
Sounds interesting.
Cliff interrupted me softly.
Maybe I should read it. And you know something? You are a pretty woman.
Maybe he had not read Wuthering Heights, and maybe he was not educated, but he was very handsome. There was no getting around that. In bed that night, I asked Charlie if he knew who Heathcliff was.
Yeah, of course. Why are you asking me? He's the character in the novel. What's it called? The novel with the crazy wife in the attic.
Do you mean Jane Eyre?
Yes, Jane Eyre.
You
you don't mean Mr. Rochester, I said.
What is this? An exam?
Charlie asked, sitting up. You must mean Wuthering Heights by Emily Bronte, I said.
Okay, I meant the guy in Wuthering Heights, Charlie said, lying down again and turning over and away from me in bed. Go to sleep, he also said.
Hindley had asked for a fiddle, Kathy for a new whip, but when their father, Mr. Earnshaw, returned from Liverpool, he brought them Heathcliff. And true, as I would learn later, Cliff never did read Wuthering Heights. At the time, a time of unapologetic social class labeling and bias, the good people of Albemarle County were divided into three groups: town, gown, and county. We were county, while Cliff was definitely town. Our neighbors, Merrill and Frank, actually they lived across the road from us, did a number of things, including running the diaper service in town and boarding horses. They also had a lot of apple trees on their property. One time when they let some of the horses out into a field where apples were lying rotting and fermenting on the ground, the horses ate them and got drunk. It was kind of funny to watch them staggering around and falling down, but it was pretty awful too. Like the whole world had all of a sudden gotten unsteady. Merrill and Frank had several children, all of them girls. Emily Bronte was also a poet. No coward soul is mine, no trembler in the world's storm-troubled sphere. I see heaven's glories shine, and faith shines equal, arming me from fear. At that cocktail party celebrating Sally's birthday, I learned that the gray horse Cliff had ridden in the race was hers. I should have guessed that. I also found out that he and Sally were sleeping together. I should have guessed that, too. Apparently, Cliff came in fourth in the race. Not that I cared. But I did. I care a lot about horses and about horsemanship. The way someone rides, I think, tells a lot about that person. For instance, Charlie is a good rider. He rides primarily from strength. I don't object to that as long as he does not abuse his strength. Charlie rides with his thighs while I ride with my ass. I ride from empathy. I try to second guess what my horse will do and anticipate it. I don't wear spurs or use a whip. I've ridden almost all my life, at least since I was 5 years old. I feel good on a horse, and the horse usually knows that. The first horse I rode was a pony called Freddy. Like a lot of ponies, Freddy was mean. Because of a Napoleonic complex, or what? Freddy did his best to buck me off, or he would reach around and try to bite me while I was mounting him. A couple of times he would get down on his knees and start to roll, but I always managed to get off him in time. Funnily enough, none of that meanness bothered or deterred me. After Freddy came Delia, a Palomino mare who was gentle and kind and on whom I learned to jump. I had Delia for 7 years, grooming and feeding her and mucking out her stall every day. I loved her dearly. Then one day while we were out riding, she shied a few times for no discernible reason. Later, when I let her out in the field, she ran smack into the fence. She had contracted what is commonly referred to as moon blindness, and officially known as equine recurrent uveitis, for which, unfortunately, there is no known cause or cure. I was heartbroken. My next horse was a tricky black colt named Balthazar, Balt for short. I had to train him, lunge him, get him used to the saddle, me on top of the saddle, the whole 9 yards. I learned a lot. Too good-looking for his own good, the same person who said Cliff was having an affair with Sally told me. He's reckless, and he's an operator. He's cheating on his wife, and I wouldn't trust him as far as I could throw him. He'd probably rob his own grandmother if he could. He's nothing but trouble, mark my words. Heathcliff's enduring appeal is approximately that of Edmund Iago Richard III, the intermittent Macbeth, the villain who impresses by way of his energy, his cleverness, his peculiar sort of courage, and by his asides inviting, as they do, the audience's or reader's collaboration in wickedness. Marilyn Frank's oldest daughter, Carol, came over and babysat from time to time. She was 14, wore glasses, and always brought a book along with her. Last time she came over, she was reading A Tale of Two Cities. Not only did I approve, I thought she seemed reliable. But she was shy and hard to talk to. "Do you kids ride over at your place?" I asked her. She shook her head. "No? Why not?"
Your dad has a bunch of nice horses there. Shrugging, she held her book up to her chest as if in defense.
I'm afraid of horses, she said.
Oh, that's too bad, I said.
The last time I rode, I fell off and broke my arm, Carol said.
Did you get back on again?
Carol shook her head. She looked as if she was about to cry.
I fell off once and broke my collarbone. I was about your age, maybe a little older, and my dad made me get right back on the horse, although it hurt like crazy. I thought I was going to pass out, I told her.
Carol said nothing.
How do you like A Tale of Two Cities? I asked to change the subject.
Leela, Bella, and Nelly, all bitches, were the names of our three dogs. Leela and Bella, the English Springer Spaniels, belonged to Charlie, and he hunted birds with them, quail, pheasant, ducks, and doves. Nelly, a Norwich Terrier, belonged to me. Nelly was 8 years old and going a little deaf, and like all terriers, she was stubborn and disobedient, and I adored her. Keeper, Emily Bronte's dog, was fierce and unruly and obeyed only her. When Emily died.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.